between the promise and its manifestation. For every believer, everyone born, there's a promise, there's a reason why we were made. There's something the Lord wants us to do for him. Some might be bigger than others, but everybody has a purpose. There's no one who came, I know we all know that, into this world without a purpose, without something the Lord has asked, called us to do or to accomplish for him. And on in scripture, we see God revealing his purpose for the lives of individuals and nations. Remember Jeremiah, he told him, he said, before you were formed in the womb, I knew you, I ordained you a prophet to the nations. There is a reason. Before Samson was born, he also told his parents, this will be a Nazarene, no razor shall touch his head, and he spoke about him. Before Jesus was born, before John was born, and on in scripture, there's always a word concerning people that are coming forth into the world. So for every one of us, there's a reason why the Lord has created us. And there's a purpose. And you know, we only fulfill purpose when we come into Christ. People achieve in the world, but there is a reason, and you can only discover that reason in Christ. And sometimes I want to presume we are born again here, every one of us. Sometimes it's like we have come to know the Lord. The Lord has made you a promise. He has told you something you will do for him, something he will do through you. And times and seasons are going by, and it's not manifesting. Sometimes as if the longer it takes, the further and further away you are getting from the purpose that God has created you for. And today we are going to look at that. Today we are going to look at somebody who had a terrible experience between the promise and its fulfillment. And we're going to be looking at the life of Joseph. It's a long scripture. I'm not going to read through it. We're reading from chapter 37 to 41. I'll just pick some scriptures. When you go home, read it yourself. Joseph was the son of Jacob. He was second to the last born. He had a younger brother. And it's a long and interesting story. Every time I read it, there's so much to learn from it. And there's always something new to learn from the story. The Bible says in chapter 37, verse 5, it says, Joseph had a dream, and he told it to his brothers, and they hated him even more. So he said to them, please hear this dream, which I have dreamed. There we were, binding sheaves in the field. Then, behold, my sheaf arose and also stood upright, and indeed your sheaf stood all around and bowed down to my sheaf. And his brothers said to him, shall you indeed reign over us, or shall you indeed have dominion over us? So they hated him even more for his dreams and for his words. And then he had another dream. Verse 9, he said he had another dream, and they hated him even more. And his father even rebuked him and said, why will you have this kind of dream? In verse 11, he says, what have you dreamed? Are you saying that we will all bow down to you? And note that his father just kept the matter in his mind. But what happened to his brothers? From verse 1, he said, the earlier verse, he said the brothers already envied him because his father loved him more than them. And he made him a coat of many colors. And then reading further on, it says, after he told them the dream, they hated him more. And the hatred now was even, they were not even concerned in whether their father loved him or not. They hated him now more because of his dream. Because of the place that he was supposed to be going. That was why they now hated him. It says they hated him even more. I looked at it and I wondered, why did Joseph have to tell his brothers the dream? Sometimes God has told you something, and you just can't keep it to yourself. You have to tell somebody. It's always good to check who you are telling, because not everybody, some people are dream killers. Some people are people that you will tell, they might not discourage you, but they will find a way. You know, there are some people that it's almost like witchcraft, an evil desire in their heart, and you see it manifesting without their saying anything. So it's always good to find out, to be sensitive to the spirit. If the Lord has told you something that is so big, you are so excited, who should I share it with before you go and speak? So that they don't put a spoke in the wheel and make the journey a longer one for you. Praise the Lord. Joseph spoke. He said the first time they were envious. He didn't learn. I guess he was a young boy. He went ahead and told them the second one. If he had just told them the first one, maybe they would have forgotten. But he went and he said, I had another dream. This one is even more. You were all, and it was like, this boy, what is it? And they hated his future. That was what they hated. They were not even bothered about whether the father liked him. No. The future, what God had planned for him, was what they hated him for. Praise the Lord. And if we read on, verse 18, it talks about when his father sent him to go and meet his brothers and say and ask find out how they were. And he says, now when they saw him afar off, even before he came near them, they conspired against him to kill him. Then they said to one another, look, this dreamer is coming. Come, therefore, let us now kill him and cast him into some pit. And we shall say some wild beast has devoured him. We shall see what will become of his what? His dreams. We shall see what will become of his dreams. So it's not about daddy likes him so much, let him get out of the way so that daddy can make us a coat of many colors. No, it was his dreams that they were after. And they said, let's see what will become of his dreams. But Reuben heard it, and he delivered him out of their hands and said, let us not kill him. And Reuben said to them, shed no blood, but cast him into this pit which is in the wilderness, and do not lay a hand on him, that he might deliver him out of their hands and bring him back to his father. There's something, you know, it's not related to this, but there's something I want to highlight here. He said, Reuben heard it and delivered them. Reuben was the firstborn. And when he saw this thing they wanted to do, he knew it was wrong. And its responsibility was on him to take action. But you see what he said? He said, don't shed his blood, just put him in the pit. He didn't tell them, if you read further and see what Judah said, it was different. Reuben said, put him in the pit, let's, you know, and he was trying, as if he was trying to deceive them, so that later he can take them back to the father. He couldn't confront them and say, we cannot do this thing. Leave this boy, because that's what he wanted. We want to take him back home. But he, you know, he was afraid. And so he said, let's put him in the pit, let him be there. And his mind, he said, later I will go and take him. But see what happened. And you know, if you read through scriptures, Genesis chapter, is it 48 or 49? When Jacob was blessing his children, what did he say? He said Reuben was as unstable as water and he will not prevail. He did not have a mind of his own. That was why he could go to, you know, it's like the temptation of his father's concubines was so strong. He could not resist and he went to sleep with his father's concubines. And Jacob said, you went up to my bed, you will not prevail. And a firstborn became just one, a firstborn. Can you imagine that? He didn't have a mind of his own. You have a mind of your own. Can you, can you stand against the crowd? Can you speak out and say, no, this thing is wrong? Because you know, every action we take affects our generations. Because of him, his generation, they were voiceless in the land of Israel. But Judah, who spoke up, became a leader. He was the one bringing leaders, raising leaders. His children were leaders in Israel. Because he spoke up. If you go further on and read verse 26, it says, Judah said to his brothers, what profit is there if we kill our brother and conceal his blood? Come, let us sell him to the Ishmaelites and let not our hand be upon him. For he is our brother and our flesh. And his brothers listened. Yes, it was what he said was not good. Let's go and let's sell him. But he made a decision and he coerced his brothers to do the right, to do some, not to kill him. He said, we can't shed his blood. Let us sell him. So he began displaying leadership from here. How are we displaying leadership at home? With our children? With people that God has given us the oversight over? Maybe your subordinates at work. Are you a leader indeed? Or are you somebody who is afraid to speak? So, and you know what happened to them? Reuben was not there when Judah spoke to them and convinced them. And Reuben came back and Joseph was not there. And he was afraid. And the Bible did not say they told him what they did with Joseph. Did you know that? The Bible did not say that. He came and met them. He said, the boy is no more there. What are we going to do? They didn't tell him we have sold him. Instead, they just said, let us, you know, take his dress and put blood on it and send it to our father and pretend that the wild animal has eaten him. So even Reuben was deceived. He who was the firstborn, who was supposed to be the leader, because he did not take his place as a leader. Are we taking our places as leaders? Praise the Lord. If you go on to chapter 39, after Jacob had gone, Joseph had gone to Egypt. Verse 2 says, the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a successful man, and he was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. And his master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord made all he did to prosper in his hand. The Lord was with Joseph. He was a successful man. How can you call it a slave a successful man? The Lord was with him. In slavery, the Lord was with him. If the Lord has made you a promise and things are not going the way they ought to, he has made you a promise, your relationship with him is still intact, then the Lord is with you. That's what the Lord is saying. The Lord is with you. He was successful as a slave. Can you imagine what would have been going through Joseph's mind? Somebody who was a spoiled child, who was favored, who his father loved more than everybody, even loved him more than Benjamin, his last born. He loved him so much, and he made him a coat of many colors. And from there to slavery, you know what slavery was in those days? The property of the boss. You can't move, you can't breathe without your boss. All your heart desire. In fact, when they had children, the children belonged to their bosses. That's how slavery was. And he was there, but he says he was successful. If the Lord is with you, even if you are in a cave, the Lord is with you. Wherever you are, the Lord, as long as your relationship with the Lord is intact, the Lord is with you. The fact that adversity has come does not mean that the Lord has left you. No. He says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. That is his word. And so in slavery, the Lord was with Joseph. And he says, verse 2 says, God blessed his master because of him. God blessed him because of him. The Lord never leaves us. And he found favor in his sight and served him. And there he made him overseer of all that he had. And when, after he had made him overseer, everything in the man's house began to prosper. There's a blessing a child of God carries. And no matter what the devil tries to do to frustrate you, that blessing manifests. It manifests. Except we don't believe that we are children and we are heirs according to the promise. The Bible says in Galatians, it says, if you be Christ, then are you heirs according to the promise. There's a promise he made to Abraham, and that promise is ours. And so if I'm a child of God, that promise manifests. No matter where I am, even if I'm under the hole, the promise manifests. I'm blessed, and I'm a blessing to those people around me. Joseph was not discouraged. Joseph did not feel, what's the point serving this God of my father? Look at what he did. Maybe I should join the idols of these people. You know, he was a slave. If he had joined them, he would have had favors there. They would have favored him. Maybe a little favor here and there, extra food, extra whatever. But he did not. He continued with his God. And it's clear in the place where he got tempted. It says in verse 8, he said the master's wife kept harassing him. Verse 7, telling him, you know, sleep with me. Every day she kept doing it. And I was wondering as I was preparing this, how many, a lot of men and women fall to temptation. They will say, one man said, Pastor, the girl just came to my office and she raised up her skirt and I just fell. And I wonder, look at Joseph. Every day, a woman was harassing, every day. Every blessed day. And you know, he didn't have anywhere to go. He was a slave there, so he couldn't run away. It's not like maybe you went to your office, somebody is tempting you, then you can run back to your house. No, he was there 24/7. So the temptation was with him every day. But what kept him? His relationship with God. It's not as if the woman wasn't beautiful. It's not as if he couldn't sleep with a woman. But he made up his mind. There's a place that says in Job, it says, I have made a covenant with my eyes. Why must I look upon a maid? He made a covenant with his eyes and said, no matter what. I can imagine that the woman must sometimes would have said, maybe the servants has also do something. She will come and say, no, it's Joseph that should do it for me. Tell him to bring it to my room. You know how many times that happened? And Joseph was able to escape. Why? Because he did not allow his flesh to prevail over him. A lot of times we allow our flesh, we allow our body to control us, and we say we're tempted, the temptation was too strong. No. Of course, the Bible says in James, say you are tempted by your own lust. It's our lust that make us fall. Have we brought our flesh under? Because when in the place of trials, when you feel that God is far, or the Lord has made a promise, it's not yet coming to fulfillment, and times are going by, temptation comes. And you know that temptation, the purpose of that temptation is to prevent you from reaching that place that God has for you. That's the whole purpose. Look at a woman who had been pursuing Joseph, begging him every day. When she eventually got to a place, when she was alone with him, and then she now held him and said, no, you must sleep with me today, and he ran away. What did she do? The love became hatred. Can you imagine that? Somebody who was after Joseph, the Bible did not tell us how long it was for, but she suddenly turned again. Somebody who was saying, come and lie with me. And she must have been promising, sleep with me, I will do this for you, I will do that for you. She was the boss's wife, Potiphar's wife, the captain of the guard. So she had powers and influence. She must have made promises to him, but he did not listen. And the same woman, when he spurned her, she turned and the hatred became as strong as the so-called love she had for him. And you know what she did? She went to report and lied against him. And said, this guy tried to sleep with me. And he ended up in jail. The people who have, you know, the enemy sends people to tempt us, to prevent us from reaching our goal. But if we allow the Lord to help us, even though they ridicule us, even though there's some trouble, the trouble will push us into our destiny. And that's what happened to Joseph. Yes, the woman, you know, they sent him to jail, but that jail was a step closer to his destiny. If he didn't get to jail, he would not have met the king's butler and the cupbearer. He wouldn't have met them. So that temptation was not for him to fall. Even though, you know, it was, I'm sure when he went to jail, he must have been wondering, what happened to me? How come, Lord, I did not fall? Because what did Joseph say? He said, how can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? He knew it was against God. And he said, I cannot do it. And imagine after doing that, after overcoming that temptation, look at the reward. Jail. Jail. And jail in those days, not like jail now, that you know some people are in jail, but they are inside a condition, they can eat whatever they like. No. Jail there, they were bound hand and feet. If you have to move, they will unlock it. You go and do what you want to do. You come and sit. There's no, and it was dungeons. You know, they were in caves under the ground. So there was no light, nothing. That was jail then. But he was there. And he did not complain. How do I know that he did not complain? Verse 21 says, the Lord was with Joseph and showed him mercy. You know, even in the times of trials, you see the hand of God. Somehow, you see the mercy of God, and you know that this is God. Even though I'm in this place, I know that God is with me. That's why the Bible says the Lord showed him mercy, and he gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. Everywhere he went, he found favor. Yet he was still going deeper and deeper, from slavery to jail. But God was with him, and the favor of God was with him. But you know one thing about Joseph? He did not lose his relationship with God. And that's one thing we should cherish and hold on to daily. Because that's the only thing that will keep a man alive. That's the only thing that will keep you alive in the times of storm. My children were running a program that just ended in a River Valley estate. And the woman, when I went to see her 2 days ago, she said her neighbor just committed suicide. Why? A man married with children, he lost his job, and his wife took the kids and left him. And he committed suicide. They just discovered his body 2 days ago. The body was smelling. He drank poison. Why? Because he felt there was no hope. And so it's only the Lord that can give you hope in a dark situation. So if you take your eyes off him, what is going to sustain you in that land of affliction? Nothing. It's the hope, it's the encouragement, the joy of salvation that keeps us. Even when we know that we are going through storms, it's the joy of the Lord that is our strength. And so if we lose that relationship, if there is a blockade, if because of sin, because of complaint, because of bitterness, then we will not be able to, you know, we can't capitalize on that love. And we can't get sustenance from there. And without hope, there's nothing. That's why that man killed himself. Another man in Lekki, somebody was going for his burial. A banker who lost his job. No money for his children's fees, no money for, and they buried him this weekend. And he just killed himself. A young man, maybe about 40. And he killed himself. So without God, there is no hope. It's the salvation of our souls that gives us comfort. It's the word of God that comforts us. It's the presence of God that gives you the strength to overcome and to wake up again the next day. Without God, there is no strength. And with the economic situation now, I'm sure it bites a lot of people. But it's the Lord that sustains us. It's the Lord that keeps us. And that's why we should maintain that relationship. Let it be so important, so precious, that nothing stands between you and God. Nothing at all. Not even the situation we are in. Praise the Lord. Verse 23 says, the keeper of the prison did not look into anything that was under Joseph's authority, because the Lord was with him, and whatever he did, the Lord made it to prosper. And you wonder, I'm sure Joseph must have wondered, things are prospering in my hand. Why am I in this situation? I can see that God is with me. When you pray for people, the Lord visits them and answers them. How come my own situation? Why is it like this? But he did not allow it to discourage him. Yes, there are times that you are down. But like the Bible says, David encouraged himself in the Lord. You need to encourage yourself to move on. You need to encourage yourself to move on. Because if you end it, or you end it wrongly, hell, that is forever. This is just temporary. Hell is forever. Do we want to leave this place and go to damnation? Or do we want to live here and continue the relationship with the Lord? Praise the Lord. And then if we go on to the next chapter, when the butler and the baker came to prison, that place is very interesting, because it says, verse 6 says, chapter 40 verse 6 says, and Joseph came in to see them in the morning and looked at them and saw that they were sad. Joseph was a prisoner. He was with other prisoners, the butler and the other guy who had offended the king. Joseph did not have any offense. His only offense was that he refused to commit evil. He refused to commit that crime. That was his offense. So it would be expected that Joseph would be discouraged. Joseph would be down. Why would he be looking at the other prisoners? Every prisoner in jail is supposed to be sad. Aren't they supposed to be sad? They are. Because from prison, most times, straight to the hangman. It's once in a while that some of them get, you know, they get clemency and they're out of jail. A lot of them in those days, from prison, after a while, they execute them. But it says Joseph was looking at them and said, I can see you are sad. Why are you sad? There's something about being in the place of, you know, in place of affliction, the place of trouble. If we are not able to reach beyond ourselves and extend help to somebody else, sometimes that help might be the access to our freedom and our breakthrough. That's what happened to Joseph here. If he did not ask them, what's wrong with you? Why are you sad? They would not have known that he had the gift of interpretation of dreams. And when the man went out of jail, yes, the butler would have gone out of jail, whether Joseph interpreted or not. He would have gone out. But would he have remembered Joseph? No. So it was Joseph's reaching out that gave him an opportunity to get out of that place. Sometimes we are in a place where we are just consumed with our own issues, our own problems. Please, let me not bother, you know, let me not bother myself. I beg, let me solve my problem. Let me sort out myself first. For how long will you be sorting out yourself? Because in that place you are, you can be a blessing or help to somebody. And with that help, either that person directly or somehow, God will bring somebody to help you. That's what happened to Joseph here. He said, why are you sad? Why are you guys so sad? And we're surprised. He said, I can see you are sad. What is making you worried? Why are you worried? Shouldn't he have been worried? Shouldn't he have been worried? He was not worried. Because he knew the promise that God had given him. You know, that promise is what sustains you. Because you know that the Bible says that, you know, the Lord has not made a promise that he will not fulfill. He says God is not a man that he should lie, or the son of man that he should repent. Whatever he has promised, he will bring it to pass. He's not man. So even if it is that things are going and it's that you're moving farther away from the promise of God for you, that promise of God will still come to pass. And that's what helps Joseph. That was why he could look at those men and say, you are sad. What's wrong with you? Let me put my own issues aside and let me attend to you. What's your problem? And they started saying, you know, they told him they had some dreams. And Joseph said, God is the one that interprets dreams. Remember, Joseph, when he was a young boy, when he had that dream, he didn't know what the dream meant. He could not interpret dreams then. That's why he was telling his brothers and his father. But he had grown in the Lord. And now he could interpret dreams. Imagine somebody who has gone through all this, but his walk with God was still intact. And he was closer to God now than he was when he was in his father's house. Is that not amazing? Because he decided to focus on God. Decided that this is my relationship with the God of my fathers. Then you know there was nothing like being born again. It was the God of their fathers that were worshipping. But he maintained that relationship with God. And you know, the Holy Spirit was not even there then. But he maintained the relationship with God. Now it's easier for us because the Holy Spirit is there with us. They didn't have the Holy Spirit. They all said, oh God Almighty, the God of my fathers, I believe you. And they kept serving, making sacrifices. That's what Joseph was doing. But he never allowed anything to tamper with it. And that's why he got to the place where he could interpret dreams. If he had not maintained his relationship with the Lord, he would not have received this gift. It would not be manifesting now. And he would not have gotten his breakthrough eventually. And so he interpreted the dreams. And everything came to pass exactly as he had said. Exactly. And you know what he said? Verse 14 of that place. But remember me when it is well with you. And please show kindness to me. Make mention of me to Pharaoh and get me out of this house. Did you see he called that place a house? I've been reading this place, you know, for years. But I never, you know, he says, get me out of this house.
He didn't see that place as dungeon.
He saw it as a house. You know, a house is a place that you go in and come out freely from. He didn't call it, later on, you know, it's like, you know, the Bible does not just use words for, just for fun. There's a meaning, there's a reason why that word was used. Because we could say, yes, Joseph was just calling it a house, he meant prison. But later on, what did he say? He said, for indeed I was stolen away from the land of the Hebrews, and also I have done nothing wrong here, that they should put me into this dungeon. So he knew it was a dungeon, but initially he called it a house. Whatever situation you are in, you are the one who should decide that I'm not limited by this place. That's what Joseph was saying. He said it's a house. Yes, he could not go out and come in. He was there for years, but he said this place is a house. I refuse to call it a dungeon. I refuse to call it prison. What are you calling your situation? Are you calling it a place of poverty? Are you calling it a place of barrenness? What are you calling it? What have you called it? Joseph said, it is a house. He was living there as if he was living in a house. What kind of spirit? It's only the spirit of God that can make a man think like that. Because that is the lowest place to be, in jail. A place where it's not like maybe after a while they'll call his case and say, yes, what did you do? Once a slave goes into jail, that's the end. But he called it a house. Have we gotten to this point where we have been put in jail? What are we calling the situations around us? What are you calling the negative situation around you? Is it a house or is it dungeon for you? You know, whatever you make of it, that's what it will be for you. Whatever you make of it, that's what it will be for you eventually. The Bible says the power of life and death are in the tongue. If he had called it jail and said, I'm hopeless, that would have been his situation. But he said what? They foot me. He said, remember me. That means he still had hope that it will come out. Something that had not happened before. What did he say? He said, remember me when it is well with you. Remember me. They were butlers. They were servants to the king. What could they have done for Joseph? But he said, still remember me. He had hope. Even in that dry and thirsty place, he had hope. And it's hope that keeps us alive. It's faith that keeps us alive. If we are forgotten the dreams and the things the Lord has promised us because we are in a dark place, then there's nothing without hope, without belief. You know, Abraham, the Bible says Abraham believed God. Against all hope, he believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. If we are children of God, then we have to believe God. You have to believe the word the Lord has spoken to you concerning your life. I can't believe for you. You cannot believe for me. You will believe for yourself. I will believe for myself. So that there will be a manifestation. And no matter how long it takes, the Lord will always come through. Praise the Lord. No matter how long it takes, the Lord will come through. He's not a man that he should lie. Nor a son of man that he should repent. Whatever he has said concerning you will come to pass. That's the word of God. It will surely come to pass. There are numerous examples in scripture of people who have gone through fire. The Bible says in Psalms, he has brought us through fire, he has brought us through the water, and he has established us. Whatever fire you are going through, whatever waters, he will establish you. He will bring you forth, and he will establish you in the name of Jesus. Tell your neighbor, he will establish you. He will establish, say it as if you mean it. He will establish you. Praise the Lord. The Lord will establish us. He doesn't owe any man. I don't believe that at the last day, any of us will be able to stand before God and say, you made me a promise and you did not fulfill it. No. But we have our own part to play. And that's what we're looking at. What was Joseph's reaction? What was his attitude between the promise and its manifestation? He had an attitude of faith. He maintains his relationship with God. He did not allow himself to fall into temptation. Of course, it doesn't mean we are perfect. Sometimes things may come. But you stand up and you pick yourself up and you keep moving. Because you know that the promise of the Lord, even though it tarries, it will come. That's what the word of God says. Except we are not Christians. Except we don't believe the word of God. Except we are playing church. Then we allow the challenges to weigh us down. But if we really believe the word of God, and we are looking at the word of God daily, then that word of God should sustain us. It should be something that we drink from to quench our thirst in a dry and thirsty land. Praise the Lord. Joseph called it a house. And indeed, it became a house for him eventually because he was able to leave that place. We should be able to prophesy to our situations. This was the spirit of prophecy upon him. He said, "This they have kept me in this, and get me out of this house. Remember me and get me out of this house." Even though he didn't know what they could do, he didn't know that they could that Pharaoh have a dream. Do you know that if Pharaoh hadn't had that dream, there's no way Joseph would have come out of it? Because will a butler go and say, "There's one guy that interpreted my dream, Pharaoh, please, I want you to set him free"? Would it have happened? It wouldn't have happened. So God knows what he's doing. That dream was what made the butler. So when he said the butler forgot, yes, he forgot. But God had to bring Pharaoh to the point where he himself would be the one to order for Joseph to come out of prison. Praise the Lord. All these stories, the Bible says this, all these things are for an example to us. They are for examples to us, for us to read, for us to study, for us to pattern our lives that way, so that we can get the results that these men of old got. If Joseph could get freedom from all this, from going into slavery, being sold into slavery in a strange land — you are not in a strange land, you are in your house, you are in your land, in a strange land with no help — into, from there into prison, into jail, without any hope of being released for at all, and he came out and became the prime minister of Egypt. What can God not do? He's a great and an awesome God. That place says, "Ah, Lord God, thou hast made the heavens and the earth by thy great power and with thy outstretched hand, and nothing is too difficult for you." Do you believe it? Do you believe that nothing is too difficult for God? I believe that nothing is too difficult for God. If he did it for Joseph, he can do it for me, and he can do it for you. But we have to be in a place where we are ready. Remember, as the story goes on, if Joseph had not maintained the relationship, like we said, he wouldn't have been able to interpret the dream. And then if after he had interpreted the dream for those men and they went out, you know, Joseph would have been depressed. He's a human being. These men came in. They committed a crime against the king. The king was angry, put them in jail. They have been released. I'm still here. What did I do? I didn't do anything. Sometimes some challenges, you'll be wondering, what did I do? What did I do wrong? My younger sister had, when she got married, she lost a lot of pregnancies. The first one, the baby was full term, 9 months, and she almost died. We almost lost her. They had to give her so much blood. The baby had a few weeks to delivery. She just had, I don't know what happened, and the baby died. She had to push out the baby, dead. No, she didn't even push out. They had to do a cesarean section for her. And it was like a dark place. And she said, "What?" She calls me, "Auntie, auntie, what did I do?" "I kept myself. I was not, what did I do? Why will God do this to me? I'm serving God." You know, and she kept talking. Sometimes when I call her, I say, "Please, I don't want to hear. You know, and it was a challenge for the family. And we kept wondering, what really is the matter? We prayed. Then my dad, we prayed. You know, so after a while, she now wrote a letter to the general overseer. And he responded, you know, he will reply with a letter. And he said, "You have children, as many children as you want, and blah, blah, blah." And she took it and put it on her wall. But after that, she took it again, and she miscarried. This time, twins, two boys. She miscarried. They had to rush her from, she was in Wari. They rushed her to Benin. One was already dead, so they wanted her to, you know, but they are twins. So as she was pushing out one, the other one also came out. And that was how she lost twins, two boys. And she was, in fact, I was shattered. I couldn't believe I couldn't imagine how she was feeling. And you know, the whole family was like, "What is happening?" And they said, "Your cervix is something, something. They have to sew." These twins, they sewed her and they kept her. And the thing fell out. You know? And it was horrible. I said, What will I do? In fact, the husband said, "You know what, sweetheart, maybe God doesn't want us to have children. Let's forget about children." You know? And she said, "No, I must have..." You know, but it was a turbulent time. Then she took in again. She had another miscarriage. You know? And you know, it was not a miscarriage of 2 weeks, 3 weeks. You will see the babies, they are dead. You know? And this went on for a while. Until finally, you know, and I thank God for the, you know, there's a pastor, one of the provincial pastors in Wari, Pastor Olumide. You know, the man was childless at that time. He was a doctor. He had a child after about maybe 18 or 20 years of marriage. He was a doctor and he kept attending to her and all that. Then she now took him for this one that is her first son now. And things were going on, they started having issues again. The water, she started draining like all, and it wasn't yet time. So they put her on bed rest. We were all praying, the whole family. Those abroad, everywhere, let's pray, every day. You know, you're afraid. If you see a call on your phone, you're afraid. I hope, you know. We're praying, you know, but we're afraid. Because I couldn't, I said, "God, let this girl not commit suicide," because the way she was, and she loved children so much. So, Pastor Olumide
when she had the baby,
that day, 3 generators packed up in the hospital during the cesarean section. 3. They will ask during the cesarean section, until we pack up, they will rush out, go and put it. Just tells you that there was something wrong. You know, it was a spiritual battle. And eventually she had the baby. The baby was still born. He couldn't tell the husband who was waiting that. He said, she's okay. Pastor Olumide couldn't tell her. You know, the man went to pray and this boy came back to life. He was praying. He said, I cannot tell this girl that this baby is dead. I cannot. And they were praying for over 30 minutes. The husband did not even know what was happening. It was later he told her, this is a man who was childless. Doing all this, he was childless. But this girl has been married for 5 or 6 years. Couldn't he have said, you have under on me that I've been here for how many years? Please relax. He didn't do that. It was as if his life depended on it. We couldn't have done anything to him. The baby died. But he prayed with his nurse. He said, this baby must come back to life. And after about 30 minutes, baby came back to life. That was when he now told Ebere, see your baby. Can you imagine that? A man who was childless. Childless. So after my sister had like 2 or 3 children, almost after she had had all her children, before this man had a child, 20 years or so after. 20 years. This is a man. You know, it's just like Joseph. He did not allow his own issues to stop him from being a help and a blessing to others. If he could pray for the baby to come back into life, why couldn't his own wife carry a child? He must have thought about it. But he did not debar him. What is it that you are going through? You can still be a source of blessing to somebody else. And then the Lord will visit you. That's how it works. That is just how it works. You can't be in such a bad place that you feel, let God sort me out first before I do anything. Then you might be there for a long time. Olumide could have said, what is it? Well, take heart. Like they always tell you, you have another one. You would have told, after all, you are even taking in. My wife is not taking in. You are taking in. Anyway, very soon you will get lucky. You have your baby. No. The baby was dead. He refused to take no for an answer. And that's how the baby came back to life. What challenge do you have that you feel you are in such a bad place that you cannot be a blessing to somebody else? What challenge? And you know, the prayers, everybody, Pastor Olumide, God bless him. My father was so, you know, in fact, he called him his son till he died. Olumide was the one that took my daddy to hospital before he died, the day before he died. He was there when my father died, Olumide. And God blessed him with twins, a set of twins, two boys, double for his trouble. But he did not, you know, his attitude was key. That's what I'm trying to bring out here. Your attitude is so important. His attitude was key. He will encourage my sister, he will pray with her, he will this and that. Even the day my father died, Olumide was the one that spoke to me. I said, you know, daddy, dada, he was the one who took him to the mortuary. That was, you know, a man who will give of himself. And God blessed him. He's not related to us. You can hear the name. He's a Yoruba man. He's not related to us. There is no whatever, whatever. But he was a man who, and as he did for us, he was doing for others. It's not just us. But every other person that came across his way. How are you being a blessing in that situation you are in? Are you overwhelmed? Are you waiting for God to do it before you do something? Don't wait for God. Do it, because it's in doing it that you get your deliverance. It's in reaching out that we get our deliverance. That's how the word of God works. And that's how he got his deliverance. I can imagine he had a maternity center, so he was delivering numerous babies. And there will be other stories like that. He could have decided that, what am I doing with this? Please let me, you know. But he did not. He kept at it. And God blessed him. Every time I see him in camp, I say, I greet him, you know, and you'll be wondering why this girl. I just, you know, there are so many memories. And I say, this man is blessed. And he's blessed. His children are blessed. Everything about him is blessed because he reached out. If that child had died, I don't know what would have happened to my sister. You know, some people have such issues and they almost go gagas. That was what was almost happening to her. Because it's different when you don't get pregnant. It's different from when you get pregnant and you see the baby and they tell you the baby is dead. Praise the Lord. The Lord will help us. I want to encourage us this morning. Don't give up. Don't give up. Don't give in to the challenges you are facing. It might be that you are far away from what the things that you feel God has said in his word concerning you. Don't give up. The word must work. The word of God does not fail. The Bible says in Acts, so mightily grew the word of God and prevailed. The word of God will always prevail because the word of God is living and it is powerful. It is life, and so it must prevail. Except we do not believe. Except we are doubting. Sometimes even in our doubt, the Lord will just surprise us. But let us move from that place to the place of faith and belief that what the Lord has said, it will come to pass. Praise the Lord. Tell your neighbor, it will come to pass. It will come to pass. And verse 23 says, yet the chief butler did not remember Joseph, but forgot him. Can you imagine? Somebody who had done that kind of thing for him, who had interpreted his dream, and everything came to pass to the letter. The other man was killed. He was reinstated. You would think that as a human being, you would say, what can I do for this boy? What can I do for this boy? What can I do? He did not make it. He forgot. The Bible says he forgot about him. That means he didn't even remember the time he was in jail. Completely. Have you helped somebody before? You have been in a place. I have a friend who they have financial issues, and they were in a place of, you know, great financial affluence. And now things are so tough. And she keeps telling me, we helped this person. We helped this other person. We were just dishing out money. And now all of them have turned their backs on us. And I keep encouraging her. I said, you know what? Forget about them. Look at God. Whatever you did, is God who will reward you. They cannot reward you. Have you been a source of blessing to somebody and you feel that, we all have done, they've forgotten me, now I need their help? No, look at God. The Bible says the arm of flesh will fail. That's what happened to Joseph here. He thought they would be the ones to help him. But God said, no, I will do it myself. So that when you come out, you will know I was the one who did it. Look at Pharaoh. After 2 years, he had a dream in chapter 41. And he had the dream. You know, they had a lot of all those enchanters and soothsayers then. And you know, while in the kingdom of God, yes, we have all these gifts. In the world too, they have those things. In the kingdom of darkness, they can tell you exactly what is happening. But this time around, you know, God made it such that the magicians could not interpret. They could not say anything. He sent and called for all the magicians of Egypt and all the wise men. Pharaoh told them his dreams, but there was no one who could interpret them for him. No one. Why? Because God said, it's time for my son to come out. When the Lord has said it is your time, nothing can stop it. He will overturn and overturn and overturn until that which he has said will come to pass, will come to pass. That's God for you. He doesn't need anybody to help him. When it is time, he will do it. He will do it. He says, Pharaoh had a dream. He could not remember. He could not get the interpretation. And then what happened? Verse 9. The chief butler spoke to Pharaoh saying, I remember my faults this day. I have sinned against somebody. This is what he did for me. And I forgot about him. Why? Because it was not time. Because if he had come out then also, he would not have been made prime minister. He would just have come out of jail. That's what would have happened to him. There's no way they would have made him a prime minister if he had come out then. But God knew that he wanted to take him to that place. That place that he had told him as a lad. And that was why God kept him there. And when it was time, God said, it's time. Pharaoh gave him that dream. And that's how he came out. And Pharaoh said, who is that guy? Go and bring him. And you know, Joseph was still waiting. Why do I say he was waiting? Because he did not lose his relationship with God. You know, nobody can interpret dreams except God. If he had lost his relationship with God, there's no way he could have interpreted Pharaoh's dream. Is it at that point he would have been saying, oh God, forgive me, please, just show me. No, no. There was no time for that. But he maintained his integrity until that point. And so he was waiting. When they said, Pharaoh has called for you, come out. They shaved him, they brought him out, changed his clothes, and brought him before Pharaoh. He was ready. Are you ready for the time of your deliverance? Are you ready for the time the Lord is going to showcase you? Are you ready? If the Lord has given you a promise, say you are going to minister for me to the nations or whatever it is in ministry, are you preparing yourself? Are you ready? The day the Lord says it's time for us to go, will you have anything to say? Will you have anything to say? What will you have? Will you be empty because you have been waiting for God to come before you begin to do that which you ought to do? If the Lord has said you are going to occupy this position, whether in government or whatever, what are you doing to prepare yourself? Even though it looks as if you are very far away, what are you doing? Is it when it's time, when they come and meet you, you say, I don't have this. I was remember there was a time that in Acme, Pastor Atoebi, you know, he would say, maybe somebody is doing something in America or whatever. You go and represent us. And on that faithful, that year, I think my visa had expired or something. I didn't renew it because I felt I'm not traveling soon. And he said, Bridget, do you have a visa so that you can go with Norua to the US? Somebody, one of our elders' daughter was getting married. And my visa was not, I didn't have a visa. That's how my husband went alone. And I learned my lesson that day. I always renew. If the visa expires, I renew it and keep it. That's just one example. Are we ready? I missed that opportunity. It could have been something great. And I missed it because I wasn't ready. I was feeling no opportunity will come. You don't know when God will come for you. So why don't you prepare? Why are we not prepared? Like Joseph, so that when we stand before the king, we can speak as oracles of God. So that when that time comes, we are prepared. I had one of my friend's sisters just had a baby at 50. She turned 50 in February. And she just had a baby, her first child. And you know, I was so, disgusted and everything when they told me that she did not even have money to buy things for the baby. And I was wondering, you have been married for a long time. You have been believing God for the fruit of the womb, and the pregnancy now came. All this while, you didn't buy anything for the child. They are abroad. They had to go to this thrift store to go and buy things. And I was sad. That's somebody who did not prepare. If you are really expecting a child, some women even buy things even before the pregnancy comes. And you are there, 50 plus. No dependence. Nobody depending on you. Even if you teach that you were not earning well, you could not buy things for this child you have been expecting from the Lord at over 50. And that's how it is for some of us. This is one example. There are so many other areas that we do not prepare for the blessing that the Lord has prepared for us. How are you preparing so that you can stand before the king and declare the counsel of the Lord? Praise the Lord. And you know, Joseph declared the counsel of God and told Pharaoh what was going to happen. What did Joseph say? He was a humble fellow. He said, Joseph answered Pharaoh saying, it is not in me. God will give Pharaoh an answer of peace. It is not in me. It's not in me. Everything about us, we know it's God. We are nothing of ourselves. That song says, all the glory must be to the Lord. Even in this place, you know, they had hyped him. The butler had spoken so much about him. He could have come and stood and said, yes, Pharaoh, tell me your dream. But he knew that even at this point, he had to acknowledge that God was the one who had given him these gifts. And he said, Pharaoh, you know what? It's not in me. God himself will give Pharaoh an answer. God himself will give Pharaoh an answer. Have we come to the place where the Lord has made room for us and we feel that we are the ones who have done it? It's because we are prepared. It's not because we are prepared. It's because the Lord had mercy on you. Sometimes we lose our miracles because of our attitude when the miracle comes. Sometimes we lose our miracle because of our attitude. Because we feel, you might not say it, but in your heart you feel, well, it was time. I did this, I did that. No, it is God all the way. And if we do not acknowledge him, then sometimes we lose our miracles. Or we don't get more than what the Lord has given us. Some people are stagnated because of that. Do we give all the glory to God? Or are we, you know, thinking that we have a hand in it? We don't have a hand in it. What is man? If it's not out the breath out of us, that's the end of it. And we are gone. The Bible says man is like the flower of the field. It's today and tomorrow is no more. That's man. 100 years or how many years we live, it's like a day before God. So let's not forget to acknowledge God in everything. Joseph acknowledged God. And after he had given interpretation, then Pharaoh said, inasmuch as God has shown you all this, chapter 41, verse 39. Inasmuch as God has shown you all this, there is no one as discerning and wise as you.
You shall be over my house, and all my people shall be ruled according to your word. Only in regard to the throne will I be greater than you. Note, he said, all my people shall be ruled according to your word. That rulership that God had promised him, that place where everybody was bowing to him, God brought it to pass. God brought it to pass. And he says, Pharaoh said to Joseph, see, I have set you over all the land of Egypt. Then Pharaoh took his signet ring off his hand and put it on Joseph's hand, and he clothed him in garments of fine linen and put a gold chain around his neck. And they went and they were crying before him, bow the knee. So he set him up over all the land of Egypt. And Pharaoh said to Joseph, I am Pharaoh, and without your consent, no man may lift his hand or foot in all the land of Egypt. Somebody who came to the land as a slave and went into jail, into the dungeon. Pharaoh is saying, without your consent, no man can lift his hand or foot. No fly will pass by without your consent. Can you imagine that? God brought the promise he had given him when he was a teenager to pass. And he says at that time, Joseph was how old? He was 30 years old. In verse 46, it says Joseph was 30 years old. Look at the number of years it took. And Joseph did not waver. Discouragement came, but he did not allow it to weigh him down. He stood with God. And as he stood with the Lord brought his promise to pass. The Lord brought his promise to pass. What has God said to you? What have you seen in the word of God that the Lord has promised his children? A promise that has not come to pass yet in your life. Will you believe God? Will you make up your mind to walk with God and see the manifestation? I don't know what area of your life it might be. It might be in your spiritual life. It might be in your business. It might be in your family. Whatever it is. As our faces are different, so are our challenges. What exactly has the Lord promised you? Maybe there's a dream you have had from childhood. And you are seeing that you are getting farther and farther. And sometimes you are wondering, time is going, it's moving fast. When will I get this thing? When will I do this thing? The Bible says, if it tarries, wait for it. Wait for it. And in waiting, what is your attitude? Is it an attitude of thanks to God? An attitude of belief that the Lord who has promised me will do it. He cannot fail. What has the Lord promised you? I know what the Lord has promised me. What has he promised you? Is there something you are believing the Lord for? Is there something the Lord has spoken to your heart about? Is there something you saw in the world and you decided to claim? And it's like, as the days are going, things are getting tougher. What exactly is it? The Lord has made a promise. He will bring it to pass. That is our God. He's a God who never fails. He owes no man. The Bible says in Luke 1:37, for with God, nothing shall be impossible. Nothing at all. Nothing at all. Do you remember Abraham, who had a child at that age? Abraham. Abraham. But he walked with God. Remember that all these people, they didn't have any, there was nobody to look up to at that time. We have them to look up to and say, okay, if Joseph made it, I can do it. They did not have anybody to encourage them. But they encouraged themselves. Abraham did not have anybody who had lived to almost 90 before having a child. So there was no example for him to follow. But he pressed on and believed God. We have all these examples in the scripture. So what is our excuse? Why won't you hold on to God? Why are you allowing yourself, people to tempt you and derail you, to seek for alternatives elsewhere? There is no help except in God. There is no help except in God. And except God helps a man, nobody can help him. It's only God who can help a man. Why don't you put your trust in him and hold on to him? He never fails. He never fails. There's a sister who came for one of our women's provincial women's prayer breakfast meetings. And this sister, we had been pastors of the church that she was in Strong Tower, Ogudu. That was about 90, maybe 1997 to 2001 or so. And then I knew her as she was older than me then. She wasn't married. She was in the prayer band. She has been there. And I ran into her. I think it was this year. And then I heard her testimony. And she got married, was it not last year? She's over 50 now. And she said when she had had so many health challenges along the way, that it was like, you know, you are not married, you don't have a child. She comes from an affluent family, but her own issues have just been, you know, one challenge after the other. And it was like, where is God? And she was in the prayer band all through these years. She has been in the prayer band, praying and praying and praying. And it was like, what is happening? She said when she turned 50, God told her, he said, you know what, you're going to call have a party, have a big party. Invite people, cook. That people will think you are. She said, but God, I'm not married. I just recovered from whether a health challenge, like a minor stroke. What will people say is wrong with me? They will wonder what's wrong. Maybe she has even gone bonkers. Because what's wrong with her? What is she celebrating? But she said, God, she was still in her father's house. And God said, have that party. And so she had the party. She called everybody, cooked, called a caterer, did everything, dressed gorgeously, danced. And God said, you give a testimony. So she gave a testimony. She said, God has been good to me. God has preserved me. Blah, 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 blah. And she said she knows in people's hearts. They were wondering, well, it is well with her. You know? But they came and they did everything and they left. He said shortly after, the Lord led her, brought her husband to her. In that same year, God brought her husband. And when the man came, she was like, you know, somebody that, you know, when you are praying, you know, sometimes you pray. But after a point, you even stop believing that the thing will happen. And she was like, me. She didn't believe it. She couldn't believe it. That this man, what did he say in me? I've had health issues. I'm 50. He's not wondering whether I will even have a child because the man did not have a child. The man said, no. God said, you are my wife. I'm marrying you. If you see her now, you won't even believe that those years, you won't believe that she was somebody who went through all that. You won't believe it. But in all those times, she was still going out, ministering, praying, everything. She did not give up. And God came through for her. Now she says she's so happy that the man loves her so much that sometimes she wonders, you know, it's like, am I dreaming? You know? Am I dreaming? Is this for real? That is God for you. God cannot fail you. He cannot. But you have to make up your mind that, yes, I believe. Because if you do not believe, nobody can help you beyond that point. It's something that everybody has to decide for himself. I can't decide it for you. Will you believe God? Or will you put your hope in something else? I wish you all the best. But if you want to believe God, then believe him all the way. And trust him. Prepare yourself for that miracle. And believe him and walk with him. Don't allow distractions. Don't allow temptations to derail you. So that when the blessing comes, you will be ready for it. Today is somebody's day of visitation. I don't know who the person is. But today is somebody's day of visitation. And the Lord was speaking to me that some of us have gotten to the point where we are. It's like you are almost throwing in the towel. But he says today there is healing for you. If only you can reach out to him and receive that healing. You are hurt. You are bruised. You feel abandoned. You feel neglected. You feel as if God has left you. But he's saying to you, I have not left you. I'm still with you. God was with Joseph in prison. He was with Joseph as a slave. He's still with you. And he loves you very much. He says he wishes above all things that we prosper and be in health as our souls prosper. That is the will of God for us. Nothing short of it. Shall we rise? I would like us to pray.